Hierbij I open this academic ceremony in which Marianti Talafati will defend the academic thesis investigating insulin resistance in human obesity with transcriptomics towards precision-based strategies. May I invite you to present a summary of your study and the conclusions of your thesis.
Dear Prorector, dear members of the committee, dear family and friends, in the next 15 minutes, I will guide you through the content of my thesis, investigating insulin resistance in human obesity with transcriptomics towards precision-based strategies. Obesity is the consequence of small increasing imbalances between energy intake and energy expenditure, which lead in positive energy balance and weight gain. Obesity is a complicated disease associated with insulin resistance, which is a risk factor for the development of cardiovascular disease and type 2 diabetes, which are cardiometabolic diseases. And cardiometabolic diseases are the number one cause of death globally. Therefore, treating obesity is quite important. Now, you might wonder, what is insulin resistance? When we consume a meal, our blood glucose levels go up, and there comes a hormone called insulin that transports the glucose from our cells into the cells for use of energy and also stored as body fat. And when this process works fine, the blood glucose levels go down, which is good for us and describes good insulin sensitivity. Now, sometimes our cells become resistant to insulin and go insulin resistance, and the glucose transport to the cells becomes less efficient. And this leads, unfortunately, for the blood glucose levels to keep rising, which is not good for us and describes low insulin sensitivity. Now, how does obesity relate with insulin resistance? In order to understand that, I would like to explain where body fat is stored in the body. So it can be stored in organs such as the liver and the muscle, but primarily it is stored in the adipose tissue. And the main function of adipose tissue is to store energy and to cushion and insulate the body. Now, in obese state, the adipose tissue has a limited storage capacity. And then when that capacity is exceeded, there is fat overflow and inflammation, which might lead to insulin resistance in the whole body, but insulin resistance in other organs. Now, the primary course of action in treating obesity is to lose weight. And that can be done with nutritional interventions that provide advice on a healthy diet and physical activity. One of the biggest challenges in the management of obesity is weight maintenance, as several individuals, obese individuals, do not respond or adhere to the intervention. And that may be partly driven by biological factors related to adipose tissue biology. Therefore, it is quite important to find more precise strategies to treat obesity. And recently, a lot of research suggests that a way that you could do that is by grouping individuals in a certain group of similar characteristics. So as I mentioned, insulin resistance develops in different organs, and that creates different insulin resistant groups. And in turn, that leads to different cardiometabolic risk groups. And we could, for instance, use insulin resistant groups to find better strategies. Therefore, the aim of this thesis was to investigate human insulin resistant groups using computational approaches. Now, a very important question is how to identify whether these groups are different. And one way that we can do that is by integrating information from obesity pathophysiology with gene expression data. And briefly, gene expression describes the process by which functional products are made from genes. Now, when we compare two groups, group one versus group two, for example, group one can have higher or lower expression of genes compared to group two. And that can give us insights for the difference in gene expression between these groups. Now, gene expression has been shown to give insights in obesity-related adipose tissue dysfunction and whole body insulin resistance. And in chapter two, we wanted to compare or relate this to muscle or liver insulin resistance. And for that, we used the Diogenes study. We found that muscle and liver insulin resistant groups had distinct adipose tissue profiles. We also saw that in the liver insulin resistant group, we had higher expression of genes related to adipose tissue cell structure. In the liver insulin resistant group, we had higher expression of genes in biological processes related to adipose tissue inflammation, which was also observed systematically. And here we think that the systemic inflammation that we observe is a mechanism linking the adipose tissue inflammation to muscle insulin resistance. Adipose tissue dysfunction is very commonly associated with the development of whole body insulin resistance, but also insulin resistance in the other organs. Therefore, in chapter two, we wanted to investigate whether disturbed adipose tissue function and insulin resistance will develop together with muscle insulin resistance. And for that, we also used the Diogenes study. We saw that for the 40% of the study participants did not have adipose tissue insulin resistance and muscle insulin resistance happen together. In the adipose tissue insulin resistant group, we also saw a higher expression of genes related to adipose tissue inflammation and cell structure, and a worse metabolic and inflammatory profile, regardless of whether the individuals were insulin resistant in the muscle or not. In the adipose tissue insulin sensitive individuals, we did not see major alterations in biological processes, metabolic or inflammatory profile. Again, regardless of whether the individuals were insulin resistant in the muscles or not. Hence, we think that these results show that an adipose tissue disturbance accompanied by insulin resistance does not always happen together with muscle insulin resistance. Now, before I continue to the next chapters, I would like to explain that there are several ways that you can find out which cells and how many of them are present in the tissue. One way that you can do that is experimentally, so in the lab. And after the big data revolution, there's another way you can do that, which is computationally. And for the purpose of this thesis, we use the computational approach. Now, adipose tissue is comprised mainly by adipocytes, but other cells are also present. And one of these can be the adipose tissue macrophages. Macrophages are a type of white blood cell, that consume and digest substances that are harmful to us. Now, macrophages play a very important role in regulating adipose tissue function, and the numbers between individuals vary. In literature, high numbers of macrophages associate with adipose tissue dysfunction and inflammation, which usually characterize the progression of obesity. Therefore, in chapter four, we investigated the contribution of macrophages to adipose tissue, and we did that by using publicly available datasets. We saw that in individuals that were characterized by high macrophage numbers, they were accompanied by lower adipocyte numbers and higher adipose stem cells. We also saw that in individuals with higher macrophage numbers, there was higher expression of genes related to adipose tissue inflammation and lower expression of genes related to adipose tissue fat metabolism. And we think that these results could indicate adipose tissue dysfunction, possibly enhanced by adipose tissue inflammation. In this chapter, we also show the value of integrating publicly available datasets and the useful application of cell type composition in adipose tissue. Now, so far, I have been talking about the adipose tissue, but there is another tissue that you can study insulin resistance, and that is the blood. And in the blood, similarly to adipose tissue, there are different cells present, and the numbers between the cells vary between individuals. Therefore, in chapter 5, we decided to compare insulin-resistant versus insulin-sensitive groups, but taking into account the differences in cell numbers between individuals. And we did that by using the CODAM study. We saw that in insulin-resistant individuals, there were higher numbers of monocytes. And monocytes are a type of white blood cell, and high numbers of it usually associate with the progression of disease. Now, in the insulin-resistant group, we also saw higher expression of genes in the blood related to inflammation, and lower expression of genes related to cellular differentiation and organization. Here we think that our results show systemic inflammation that is possibly caused by an innate immune response or whole body insulin resistance. And because our data are in blood, we think that this could possibly reflect obesity or insulin resistant organ dysfunction. And finally, in this chapter, we also see that taking into account the differences in cell numbers makes a difference when analyzing this type of data. In conclusion, I have shown you distinct insulin-resistant groups in the development of type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease. I have also showed you the additive value of results presented in this thesis could help identify functional subgroups with different functional subgroups of obese individuals with different risk profiles that could present a starting point for future research, precision-based strategies for the prevention.
University, Professor Mariman was the chair of the assessment committee and he is the secretary of the degree committee.
But as usual, there are always questions remaining. And I want mainly to go with you to chapter 4 about the adipose tissue. And as you mentioned already, there you use to distinguish the different cell types in the adipose tissue, the computational method described by Lenz et al. But I would like to ask you, what is actually the reliability of that method? Because I read in the manuscript that, for instance, of 21 cell types, 11 have not been found in experimental sets. So what is the value of this method? And can we rely on it? What is your opinion?
Yes. Highly esteemed opponent, thank you for your kind words and for your questions. To answer to that question, yes. So indeed, in their manuscript, Lenz et al., they do mention that several cell types they cannot find back into literature. But in our data set and in our analysis, a lot of these cell types that do not come from adipose tissue, for instance, are found in our data set with very, very low numbers. Therefore, we think that the way that the algorithm works and the way that the method has been described is quite beneficial for studying adipose tissue dysfunction. Importantly, one thing, of course, another thing that is quite important here to mention is that one of the caveats of this methodology is indeed that several cell types do not originate from adipose tissue. Mm-hmm. But the authors have actually created a signature matrix with four cell types that are directed to adipose tissue. And they have compared the results between their the signature matrix, which they call 8021, and another signature matrix that they call 84. But in our analysis, also in also their paper, they mention not major differences between the estimates that they find. And also when we perform the analysis, because I actually performed the analysis with the 84 as well, I did not observe the results did not change materially. Okay. But the reason why we stuck with the 8021 is because we were interested specifically in macrophages, and in the other signature matrix that Lenz et al. Use, they combine monocytes and macrophages in one cell type.
Okay. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Yeah, overall, I think this algorithm proved to work quite well. And right. The findings also that we present in this thesis align quite well with the yeah. literature.
Okay, thank you. That's clear. You trust this method.
Yes,
I'm almost convinced.
Okay, a little bit more, and I convince you.
So when you apply it now on the adipose tissue, you can distinguish between people with low levels of macrophages and higher levels of macrophages.
Correct.
I just want to ask you what may cause the different levels of macrophages in these people. Can you speculate on that?
I can definitely speculate, but at least from what I would like to mention, just to clarify this, I can speculate related on literature, but unfortunately, because this method was solely created by publicly available data sets, a lot of clinical information is not available to us.
Right.
So the associations that I have made is based on literature. And for instance, obesity can be one of the reasons that we have high numbers of macrophages, yeah. Adipose tissue dysfunction, of course, and inflammation.
Yeah. Because I saw in your discussion, you often refer to obesity and insulin resistance to
yes.
explain your findings, but actually you don't know
no.
anything about these people, isn't it?
We have some information, which I have included in the supplementary files. And some of these individuals have information on sex, for instance, but okay, that's not maybe the best example. But I have a bit of information on whether these individuals are obese or not, whether they are lean, and whether they have, for instance, insulin resistance or not.
Would you advise for next time also to include, is it possible to include these phenotypic data, or are they not stored in these database, in the database?
So that is a common problem with the publicly available data sets. And this is something that it would be very nice to be improved in the future, and clinical meta information to be included in the data sets. But unfortunately, a lot of the times that's not the case because of privacy reasons. So these are sensitive information that is not reposited against with the data. But of course, another thing, if I can comment on that, is that usually it's not compulsory that you upload all this information. So a lot of people do not feel the urge to do it.
Okay. Then I want to briefly look at the methods that you used. First, a little bit chapter 2, figures 2.2 and 2.3. In 2.3, you make a nice depiction of these pathways mm-hmm. with their genes.
Mm-hmm.
But when I look at A, this focal adhesion, liver versus no, I see only upregulated genes, while in figure 2.2, focal adhesion is considerably downregulated. So I would expect that you would have blue genes instead of red. What's happening there?
Yeah, so for the creation of these networks, we indeed selected several of the most enriched processes, right? And the genes that went along with it. And the genes that we were selected were based on a certain threshold that we use for the log fold chains, right? Okay. And by the way, actually important to mention, the figure 2.2, that you see doesn't show that the processes are done or up or down regulated.
Uh-huh.
It just shows that they are enriched or not. So we do not have information on whether the pathways are up or down regulated. So the information that we have is whether they are enriched. So that's one difference. And for the particular genes that were selected on the pathway, for the liver insulin resistant groups, the one that you see in figure 2.3 are indeed upregulated.
Okay. Then I want to go back to chapter 4, because you did kind of similar analysis on the differential genes, comparing M0 with M3, yeah?
Correct.
But then looking at figures 4.3 and 4.4,
mm-hmm.
for that analysis, you selected the upregulated genes, and then you just take them and say, oh, these processes are upregulated. You just seem to ignore the downregulated genes in these pathways.
We do not ignore the downregulated genes. Actually, I have included the percentage of the downregulated genes into the pie diagrams. Yeah. So you have an understanding of yes. that primarily these processes that have been selected.
But when I look at figure 4.4, I see quite considerable pie charts that have red and blue almost equally. So I wonder, isn't it not a bias that you select first only the up or only the downregulated, and then you say, oh, this pathway comes out and that is downregulated?
Yes, there is always a bit of bias when we select certain processes, but in order to avoid this bias, what we did is to make sure that we represent the whole spectrum of the genes that we found, because when we find a process either that is supposedly downregulated, and in this case, mostly they were, we wanted to show that indeed there can be the genes that are upregulated, and that's why we chose this visualization to be as transparent as possible with the genes that are present in the processes that we present.
Okay, okay. Just a question about the results then, okay. Maybe the final question. You find, let me see, impaired adipocyte differentiation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In the people with increased inflammation, with more macrophages, there is decrease of adipocyte differentiation apparently. What could be the consequences, or are there no consequences of that?
Yes.
If you lower the adipocyte differentiation in the tissue.
Yes, I think definitely that would have metabolic consequences in the adipose tissue function, and possibly that could also relate with how individuals with have high numbers of macrophages could potentially react to a certain intervention, for instance. So there could be definitely consequences on that
okay,
phenotype.
Thank you for your answers, and I give the word back to the Prorector.
The opposition will be continued by Professor Willems van Dijk, Professor Genetics and System Biology at the Leiden University Medical Center. We highly appreciate your contribution and participation to this academic ceremony. Professor Willems van Dijk.
Thank you, Mr. Rector. First of all, Mrs. Candidate, I would like to congratulate you and your team on the completion of your thesis. I've read it with great interest, and your chapters together contribute to insight in tissue-specific insulin sensitivity. And as a geneticist interested in insulin-resistant and type 2 diabetes, my focus is really on the basis of heterogeneity in disease susceptibility, and your work provides insight into the mechanisms, or at least some of these mechanisms, that might underlie some of this heterogeneity. However, I'm not here to talk about my work, but exchange thoughts with you about your work. And first, I would like to ask a question about chapter 2. But before I do this, I would like to ask one of your paranymphs to read out loud proposition number 1.
An increased systemic inflammatory profile is a mechanism linking the increased expression of inflammatory genes in abdominal subcutaneous adipose tissue to muscle insulin resistance.
Okay, thank you very much. This proposition implies that there is a causal role for adipose tissue inflammation in muscle insulin resistance. And I would like to know, you know, whether that's really what you think is going on, whether there's a very specific etiology to the development of insulin resistance in obese individuals, whether it truly goes from, you know, from inflamed subcutaneous adipose tissue to muscle as a general rule.
Highly esteemed opponent, thank you for your kind words and your question. So I would like to first clarify that maybe I cannot say for a fact that there is a causal relationship here. So we propose that this could be indeed a mechanism that relates subcutaneous adipose tissue inflammation, the systemic inflammation that we observe could be the mechanism linking subcutaneous adipose tissue inflammation to muscle insulin resistance. And we have performed extensive analysis to show that, starting from, the data that we present, the gene expression data. And based on this inflammation that we saw consistently, we hypothesized that the inflammation that we observe in the transcriptome could lead to secretion of adipokines. And as a result, then that would increase the inflammation in the periphery. And that's a bit my idea on it. So that's the proposition and how we came up with that phenotype and that finding.
I would like to sort of challenge you on how you think that in general obesity leads to insulin resistance in various tissues via inflammation. So what do you think is actually sort of the cause? And that may very well be very individual specific, but what do you suppose is happening on average with an obese individual when they get obese and insulin resistant?
So if I understand your question correctly, please correct me if I'm wrong. The presence of inflammation is a major contributor to insulin resistance and obesity, and that is supported by a lot of literature. And that is one of the hypotheses, for instance, that leads to possibly leads to insulin resistance. Another of the hypotheses that, could potentially lead to insulin resistance is what I try to briefly describe in my presentation, that relates, to when the adipose tissue cannot store the body fat anymore, and that leads to fat overflow. That's another way that you could potentially have enhanced insulin resistance. But in a lot of literature and papers that we read, I would say that it's never one thing, it's a combination of factors. So it's difficult to say that only inflammation or only fat overflow would lead to insulin resistance. So definitely it's a combination of different things.
Okay, yes, then I'm going to challenge you a little more, because now I'm going to say, I don't think there's really good proof that inflammation is more than a sort of an epiphenomenon. So if I propose to you the hypothesis that it's really the fat overflow that does cause inflammation, but the fat overflow is the primary problem. And then when it cannot be stored anymore in the subcutaneous adipose tissue, it goes to other organs and causes havoc there. So it may either go to muscle or it may go to liver. And the inflammation that you see is really just what happens when tissues go into crisis because they cannot store what they're supposed to store. So what evidence do you think there is that it's more than an epiphenomenon?
It's more than epi, sorry?
Sort of a side effect. So it's something that happens because of so it's not really causal. It's a side effect.
I agree and disagree in the sense of there is a lot of evidence that show that inflammation is not, it is a side effect, yes, in that way. I hope I understand the term side effect correctly here, but it's something that happens, inflammation after the secretion of several cytokines and adipokines, because I would suppose that I agree with you, that is a side effect.
So the question really is whether these inflammatory cytokines are then causal for subsequent problems, or whether it's actually the overflow or the fat overflow that causes the problems. So that's sort of why I hear what your thoughts about, whether what's the real cause, the fat or the inflammation?
My real thoughts is exactly what I told you. I think it's a combination of factors, and it would be very difficult for me to say it's only one. So I do think both inflammation and fat overflow are detrimental to insulin resistance, for insulin resistance to happen in the body.
Okay, so then basically continuing on your train of thought, do you think then that putting a brake on inflammation, so inhibiting inflammation, so giving people with insulin resistance anti-inflammatory agents would help them develop subsequent pathology like type 2 diabetes? So with regard to intervention, would anti-inflammatories be an intervention?
Your question is whether I believe that anti-inflammatory agents would benefit individuals with insulin resistance.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, I do believe that. And there has been quite some research showing that a lot of anti-inflammatory agents are beneficial for the improvement of insulin resistance in obese individuals. So, obese individuals also, of course, with insulin resistance. So that certainly could be a strategy for improvement of their metabolic status.
Yeah, because so far I see very little, because there's lots of anti-inflammatory treatments, but very few have reached it towards the clinic, right? For type 2 diabetes. So why is that?
Yes, because I think there is more research needed. And as I also propose in my thesis, I believe that grouping and individuals based on their insulin resistant phenotype is a first step to do that. Then we have to, based on these phenotypes and the characteristics of them, the metabolic characteristics, we need to define several treatments. And as far as I know, at least for the phenotypes that we present in my thesis, these are quite new phenotypes, and there still needs to be a lot of research either with anti-inflammatory agents or with how they react to a certain intervention. So that, I think that is the reason why, because it's quite it's the moment that it happens, and we need to look into the future. And from that point onwards, with the research that we potentially, and I hope part of my thesis as well, potentially give some more insights to adipose tissue dysfunction, this information can be used for either anti-inflammatory treatment or strategies to reduce inflammation in those individuals.
Okay, so lots of work to do still. So I think my time is up, Mr. Rector.
Fine, thank you.
Then I give the word back to the rector.
Thank you very much. The opposition will be continued by Dr. Moerland from the Bioinformatics Laboratory and the Department of Epidemiology and Data Sciences at the Amsterdam University. Dr. Moerland was also a member of the assessment committee, and we highly appreciate that you are willing to join this ceremony.
Thank you, Mr. Pro-Rector. Dear dear candidate, so of course, also I would like to congratulate you with your thesis, which I read with great pleasure. I think you clearly showed that solid bioinformatic approaches and reuse of publicly available data can really shed light on insulin resistance. And of course, being a bioinformatician, I would first like to discuss with you in a bit more detail the deconvolution approaches that you used and how you applied them. So in your introductory lecture, you already nicely explained how these deconvolution approaches work. So you try to estimate the cell type proportions in specific samples and then try to incorporate these in your analyses. But maybe can you briefly explain why it is important to actually correct for these differences in cell type proportions? So what is the actual reason to do so?
Esteemed opponent, thank you for your kind words and for your question. So as we saw in chapter 5, it is indeed quite important to at least check whether differences in cell type numbers, cell type proportions, affect the analysis. And as I saw, it does in this case affect the analysis. And the reason for that is that so for the cell types that would be overabundant, they will take over the gene expression into a sample, and then this is something that we need to take into account. So in our case, in chapter 5, we saw that indeed monocytes, for instance, were overrepresented in our samples, and that could potentially lead to interference with the analysis, which, as we saw, it did.
So they are referring to the fact that here the proportions are confounded with the groups of interest that you want to compare.
Correct.
So the danger, I would say, it's a danger of having false positives if you don't correct for it, right? So you will see genes that are differentially expressed, but completely driven by the difference in cell type proportions between the groups.
Yeah, in most of the cases that happens indeed. What I propose with my approach is to at least check whether that is the case. Because, for instance, in chapter 4, we also corrected for difference in cell types. But in this case, in the adipose tissue, we actually didn't see major changes in the analysis. Therefore, the results were not did not materially change. But in chapter 5, also another important aspect is, of course, our data was in blood. And blood is a tissue that is comprised by several cell types. Well, the same as adipose tissue, of course, but also it could potentially reflect changes, organ-specific changes as well. And that is one of the reasons that we think that, correcting for cell type proportions is very important.
Still, I think this is still along the lines of trying to eliminate false positives. But do you not also think that there's a risk of false negatives if you don't correct for cell type heterogeneity? So that you don't find certain genes differentially expressed because of these changes in proportions. And why would that be the case?
So you mean in this? So if I would not correct for the cell type proportions, that I would find?
You wouldn't find.
That I wouldn't find.
Yeah.
So in this specific case, yes, that's always something that could potentially happen.
Yeah, and why?
Because samples are different, and indeed there can be a cell type, as I mentioned, a bit more abundant than the other cell types, and this can interfere with the analysis that we do.
Yeah. So in a statistical sense, why would it interfere?
Correcting for the cell types or not correcting?
Yeah, let's move back again. So not correcting for the cell type, why might this lead to not identifying genes that are actually differentially expressed?
I think, as I said, unless I do not understand the question, but is overexpression of other genes would cloud the actual results and the difference between two groups of interest. So the insulin
resistance. I fully agree with that.
All right.
Yeah, I think you understood my question. But then I was kind of surprised that, so in chapter 4, you applied this on gene expression data. So you estimated proportions on gene expression data and then correct for these. Mm. But in chapter 5, you use matched data, but DNA methylation data to estimate the proportions, and then you apply these estimated proportions to the gene expression data.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in the discussion of the chapter, you say that, well, I do this because otherwise it might introduce bias. So which type of bias are you referring to?
So it is quite common in statistical analysis that when you use the same information to estimate cell type composition, but also perform the differential gene expression analysis, there is a literature showing that this actually introduces a certain kind of statistical bias. So using DNA methylation to estimate the cell type composition. We take, we try at least to take out this potential bias in the analysis.
Is that I would maybe argue the other way around,
really?
By estimating it on a different data set than to which you apply from. And I know it's matching, it's the same individuals, but you might be misestimating the actual proportions. So my point would be that you introduce bias.
Yeah, that is definitely something that could possibly happen, I suppose. Yes, I believe that when we introduce one more form of data into the analysis, and in this analysis, the DNA methylation data, we actually help the analysis to perform in a more independent manner. And it's quite important to be able to, in this unique chance that we had actually with the CODAM study, to integrate information in a way with different data types. So we had RNA sequencing and we also had DNA methylation data, and that gives us a unique opportunity to create an approach that is not so driven by if we would only analyze, for instance, the RNA sequencing data.
So very short last question, if I still may, Mr. Rector. Yeah. But maybe there's another advantage of actually estimating cell type proportions from DNA methylation data instead of using gene expression data. Or is there not?
What do you mean?
So what could be the advantage of using DNA methylation data to estimate cell type proportions?
Well, in the analysis, the way that we did it was in order to be able to be more, to not introduce bias, as I mentioned, but also another way to think about it is that we also utilize, at least as I see it, an advantage to utilize another data source.
Yeah, but more from a biological point of view.
And that it would give us information not to the epigenetic signatures, you mean?
So I would suspect that this is more stable.
Yeah, indeed.
Maybe a more stable way of estimating.
Now I understand where you're going. Yes. Yeah indeed. DNA methylation is a more stable data type than RNA sequencing. Yes.
Thank you. Thanks for the discussion.
The opposition will be continued by Professor Shiri Svertlov, Professor Hepatic Inflammation and Metabolic Health at the Maastricht University, and she was also a member of the assessment committee.
Dear candidate, first I would like to join the other opponents in congratulating you and of course the entire promoting team for your excellent book. I personally read it with a lot of interest. I think your book contributes a lot to our understanding about the organ-specific insulin resistance and the mechanisms involved. And as such, it's definitely important for chapter two. In systemic low-grade inflammation is correlated with muscles insulin resistance, but not with liver insulin resistance. So my first question is, did you expect this or not? And maybe you can explain why.
Hi, esteemed opponent. Thank you for your kind words and for your question. To answer your question, what happens in this situation? Yes, we were a bit surprised actually that we did not find strong inflammation in the liver, but this might originate from a differential in vivo blood supply between the tissues. So the liver may be more strongly affected by the portal vein blood supply, but also factors that originate from the visceral adipose tissue and the gut. And in the case of while the peripheral tissues, such as the muscle, might be more affected by the peripheral circulation. And indeed, the subcutaneous adipose tissue drains more systematically, and that could potentially affect skeletal muscle insulin resistance more than hepatic insulin resistance.
Yeah, so that's the explanation. Why did you expect differently? Maybe you can elaborate on this. Why did you expect that there will be more correlation with the liver?
For the inflammation or for the...
Yeah, so, I mean,
yeah, so there is... Did I understand your question correctly? Why don't I see inflammation in the liver, or why I would expect to see?
We know that insulin resistance is correlated with steatosis, right? So I would expect that if there is steatosis on the liver, I guess you don't have this data, but if there is hepatic insulin resistance, you think, okay, there's also a chance that there is steatosis there and mainly maybe also trigger inflammation at some point. So what is actually the correlation now that you expect between the insulin resistance and the steatosis in the liver? Do you think there is, that in this case, there is more, myosteatosis in the muscles, and therefore this is what you see, or how does that fit here, the entire fat?
So what we have hypothesized in chapter two is that the data that we have in the subcutaneous adipose tissue could potentially reflect processes that are related to extracellular matrix remodeling, because that's what we see for the liver insulin resistance phenotype, and in fibrosis in the liver, which could...
Also there I would like to interrupt you. This is also another sign, because if there's fibrosis in the liver, you would also expect that there must be some kind of inflammation, right? I mean, that's not always the case, but it suggests that mostly there will also be inflammation involved. So that was also a surprising finding to see these changes in the ECM genes.
That is true. Inflammation is usually indeed associated with hepatic insulin resistance, steatosis, and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. But unfortunately, with the data that we had, we could not find that association. So we did not find insulin. We did not find inflammation characterizing the liver insulin resistant phenotype. We performed several analyses, starting from the gene expression, but also then looking at the inflammation markers from two independent cohorts that we used, the CODAM and Maastricht study, and still consistently we did not see inflammation. So I would very much, if you have a proposition of why this could happen, that could actually be finally to understand, to find out why.
Okay. And what is more, let's say, clinically worse, to have muscles insulin resistance or liver insulin resistance?
With the data that we have, for me, it's quite difficult to make that distinction between the phenotypes. But we could, of course, see their metabolic characteristics. For instance, in the table 2.1. And we can see that both the muscle insulin resistant and liver insulin resistant are phenotypes that are metabolically disturbed. But in an analysis, actually, the phenotype that was had a worse metabolic profile, if I can say it like this, was actually the combined group that had both muscle and liver insulin resistance.
Okay. So the combined group is, I guess, a further step in the development of insulin resistance. So it starts with the specific organ mostly, and then when you have both of them, that's more severe. That's why it's considered to be more severe.
Since this is a cross-sectional study, it's hard for me to make that causal association, but it could be that a muscle or liver insulin resistant phenotype is a precursor of muscle and liver insulin resistant group, for instance. But that's a hypothesis. I do not know for a fact.
Okay. And since you already mentioned the causality, and you were asked similar questions before, but I would like to ask whether it's also possible the other way around. We talked about the contribution of inflammation to insulin resistance. Is it possible that insulin resistance develops a specific organ also contribute to the systemic low-grade inflammation that you see?
In literature, yes, that is supported indeed. And it has been shown in several studies that systemic inflammation is a major contributor to insulin resistance. But for my particular study, I cannot infer into causality. But we do hypothesize that indeed, with the data that we have and the analysis that we performed, that could potentially be the mechanism linking the subcutaneous adipose tissue inflammation with muscle insulin resistance.
So Since causality is not yet clear, and we talk about precision medicine here in the future, maybe you can describe to me what will be your steps in order to take these studies, what still needs to be done before you can translate it into personal medicines, and what will be your main target, the insulin resistance in a specific tissue or the inflammation?
Yeah. That's a difficult question, at least based on the results of my thesis. I would say that a major target could be adipose tissue inflammation and adipose tissue function overall. So that's what I see, at least with the results presented in my thesis. And I would be very interested in seeing whether the phenotypes that we present, for instance, in chapter two, respond differentially to a treatment, because so far, at least to the best of my knowledge, there are a few studies that have actually looked into these phenotypes in more detail and saw how they respond to diet, and they have seen that a muscle insulin resistant group responds better to exercise, for instance, that you can improve insulin sensitivity with that approach. And for the liver insulin resistant group, it has been shown that metformin could be more beneficial.
Yeah.
And I know that currently in the group of human biology, my colleagues are actually performing intervention studies to see how these groups perform.
It's very interesting. I would like to elaborate more, but I think my time is finished. So I would like to thank you for your answers, and I give the word back to the
Thank you very much. The opposition will be continued by Dr. Wouters from the Department of Internal Medicine and Karim at the Maastricht University Medical Center.
Thank you. Dear candidate, I also would like to congratulate you on this work. Working with these big data sets, although you do seem to like bioinformatics very much, it still is challenging, because you need to integrate also the biology and the techniques of doing so, and your diverse expertise in the promotional team acknowledge that. And you have seemed to integrate all these parts of expertise quite well. And you seem to like big data as well, because most people put like one sentence quote on their thesis and you made a two-pager of it. So it's completely in character, I think. For my question, I would like to go a little bit more, elaborate a little bit more on what Professor Sverdlov asked you, but I would like to perhaps tackle it from the other way around, if I may. Because you showed that subcutaneous adipose tissue is linked inflammation in subcutaneous adipose tissue is linked with muscle insulin resistance, and that is also found in the circulation. And then in your discussion, you say, well, liver phenotypes are more perhaps linked to visceral adipose tissue. Of course, you don't have that data in these people, but when looking at table one of chapter two, there does seem to be a difference there, because the muscle and the liver insulin resistant have the same BMI, but their fat distribution is completely different. They have a bigger waist, but more fat-free mass and less body fat. So would that actually suggest, do you think that they do have more visceral fat?
Esteemed opponent, thank you for your kind words and for your question. So, to answer to your question, in table 2.1, body fat and fat-free mass between the muscle insulin resistant group and the liver.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So, indeed, these two measures are in the literature associated with a more disturbed visceral adipose tissue that also associates with liver insulin resistance. And it could be speculated, indeed, that this could also be one reason why we see that. That's a good suggestion, thank you. But for instance, for the body fat between the muscle and liver insulin resistant group, there is no significant difference between them. Yes, indeed, it is higher, of course, in the muscle group. But it's hard to make a...
No, I agree. It's speculative.
Yeah,
but you agree that it might be possible?
It could be possible, yes, indeed.
Then I was surprised because I always thought, and also in my hands-on experience, that visceral fat is actually more inflammatory than subcutaneous fat. So I would actually expect, if that is the one that's linked to liver insulin resistance, that the liver insulin resistance would be actually also linked to more inflammation, which is not. So how come? Can you think of a reason why that could be? Could it be to the location of the visceral fat close to being close to the liver, or the abundance between visceral and subcutaneous fat? That what's your thoughts on this?
Yeah. So indeed, the research has shown that these two tissues respond slightly differently when it comes to fat accumulation. And the visceral adipose tissue is usually the one that is stronger associated with insulin resistance, whereas the subcutaneous adipose tissue has also the buffering capacity. And it could be indeed that because of the different location that these two tissues are, that one of them is more affected, as I also mentioned in my thesis, from instance from the portal vein, so and other factors around the visceral adipose tissue, of course, and the gut. And the subcutaneous adipose tissue, because of its location, it's affected by the periphery mostly. So location, of course, is a very important factor on inflammation and insulin resistance.
Okay, thank you. I completely agree with your answer. Right. And then I would like to bring you to chapter 3, where you actually look at another type of insulin resistance, but using, if I'm not mistaken, the same study, right?
Correct.
My first question is actually a little technical, but because the liver insulin resistance and the hepatic insulin resistance, you calculate the liver and the muscle insulin, you calculate based on the same glucose tolerance test data, right? But the adipose tissue insulin resistance, you calculate in a completely different way. So I was just wondering, conceptually, is it fair to compare these?
So this surrogate markers that we use, indeed, for the muscle and the liver, they use the OGTT curves to do that. Yes, that's a different approach from the adipose tissue insulin resistant index, which is the fasting, the fatty acids, and and these actually surrogate markers, either it is for the muscle or liver and the adipose tissue, have actually been shown in literature to really correlate quite well with how the tissue responds to insulin resistance. And they have also been validated against the CLAMP studies. So in that sense, I don't think it's unfair to use these different approaches, if I may say. I think these are actually very good methods to characterize these individuals.
Okay, thank you. I'm happy with you.
Marianti Calafati, the time appointed for defending your thesis has passed. The degree committee will now withdraw to discuss the quality of your thesis and your defense. I request that you and your company await the results of our deliberations and our return in this room.
almost done.
Marianti Calafati, the degree committee here present has assessed the quality of your thesis and your defense. In view of its positive verdict and taking into account your previous qualifications, the degree committee has decided to grant you the degree of doctor. Professor Black is authorized to confirm upon you this academic distinction in accordance with Dutch university custom. I invite your supervisor to now take the floor.
Do you promise to work in accordance with the principles of scientific integrity at all times, to be careful and honest, transparent, independent, and responsible?
I promise.
By the authority vested in us by law, and in conformity with the decision of the committee here present, I hereby confer upon you, Marianta Calafati, the degree of doctor, and grant you all rights attached by custom and law. As evidence of this, I now present you with the degree certificate signed by the rector, the secretary, and the other members of the committee, and affixed with the official seal of the university. So, dear Dr. Calafati, I'm the first to congratulate you. Very well done. And before handing over to Michiel for the Laudatio, a few brief words from my side. I like very much the parallel you draw in your thesis with the poem of Odysseus going to his homeland, Ithaca. You indicate it's not only the goal that is important, but also the way towards the goal, all the efforts you invest, all the challenges you face, and all the things you learn during that tour. I fully agree with that, but I think for today you have to be very proud on the goal of what you achieved. So very, very well done. And secondly, very briefly, I like very much also the front page of your thesis. I studied it yesterday in more detail. So I was mainly involved during your last year, last year of the journey. Perhaps we already saw to some extent the coast, but it still took some time. And you see you here standing up front, a typical Mirella, taking the lead, enthusiastic about all suggestions and ideas. I think you, also with respect to analysis, you analyze data sets in many different manners. And sometimes that may have been also a little bit chaotic. But we see also on the boat your supervising team to steer and direct now and then. I think, again, very well done. You were a very appreciated member of our team, integrated very well, despite the fact that times were hard during COVID times, but a very pleasant and social colleague to work with. So all the best, and now I pass over to Michiel.
Thank you so much.
Right, dear Dr. Calafati, dear Mirella. First, I want to congratulate you, of course, on this major achievement, and I would also like to extend my congratulations to your family and friends who are either here in this beautiful location, beautiful weather, or online in their own, hopefully equally beautiful locations and weather. As has been hinted already by Alan, your journey as a PhD student has not always been easy. You started your travels with a different crew, and just like any other PhD student in the room will tell you, the less said about year one, the better. You were lost at sea with different captains pointing in different directions. And when I joined halfway through your second year, we together decided to turn the ship around and start anew. Sometime later, after Tina had joined, we felt we were finally going in the right direction. But then, unfortunately, we ran out of wind and did not know what to do anymore. We ended up choosing our own lifeboats, and for a short time, we even went our separate ways. One of the previous captains, even for reasons that to this date remain elusive, gave you a bucket of paint for a fresh start. You did not accept this, and you were right to do so. You returned to the ship, but with a different crew, and that is the team that is present here today with Ellen and Marlene. I think throughout this ordeal, you demonstrated incredible strength and perseverance, and just like the Odyssey, the end is happy. Okay, yeah, there was a significant amount of bloodshed and not all of the crew made it in the end, but it's about the journey, and this one you will remember, I think, for the rest of your life. In case it wasn't very obvious, your beautiful thesis cover resonated quite strongly, also with me personally. In your thesis, you applied a wide range of bioinformatics approaches to understand impairments in metabolism at the cellular level. You collaborated with many other researchers with different backgrounds and expertise, and I think that's a major strength. Also, based on the defense today, this content resonated with fellow bioinformaticians, more people that are curious about bioinformatics, I would say, but also clinicians and wet lab researchers. You also presented your work at conferences, including a talk at the annual Dutch Diabetes Research Meeting, with good scientific discussions and good feedback. I believe this speaks to the quality of your work, and you should be very proud of that. All right, so it was quite a journey, and I've known you now for several years, and I think there's quite a few things that we actually agree upon. The one thing that I think we agree upon is that cats are simply better than dogs. Yeah, sorry, dog people, but yeah, I'm not even sorry, because, you know, facts. I also strongly agree with the central dogma, that is, to celebrate everything on any occasion. For example, you sent personalized gifts to everyone of the promotion team after you received your thesis approval, and that's very kind, and it also shows who you are as a person. And when one of your chapters was finally accepted for publication, we, together with Tina, celebrated by drinking champagne in one of Maastricht's beautiful parks. Naturally, while adhering to strict COVID-19 rules and regulations, and also inspired by novel traditions and strict park regulations, unfortunately, wait, I'm going to put it down, but also ignoring Maastricht Park regulations doing this. Unfortunately, though, we did not finish our conversation about why Radiohead is the best band ever. And again, sorry, Radiohead deniers, this is simply the truth. You may seek support with dog owners, they're in the same boat, and grief is best when shared. I think also that we agree that we should do work that motivates us and makes us happy. And I think that is something that was not always the case during your PhD, but I'm very happy to see that you've landed a new position at a company called The Hive. And maybe to people that are less familiar with that company, The Hive sounds like a collection of drone workers working towards some vague goal that only their master is aware of. But actually, I know the company quite well, and I know that there's a bunch of good people with good vision, and it's a good environment, and I hope that you can develop your skills and that they welcome you there. One thing that I do regret is that I did not manage to teach you how to make proper bread. Because everyone, likely also people in the audience, know Dutch bread is simply not good. Fresh Dutch bread is like a sponge cake, but without the qualities that you would normally associate with a sponge cake. Bread that is a day old is for the ducks, and bread after 2 days is mostly for self-defense, I would argue. Like many others during the COVID-19 crisis, I turned a hobby of mine into really literally my daily bread in that sense. And thankfully, Maastricht University keeps reminding us we're lifelong learners, so there's still time. All right, so I would like to end with a quote that you might also know that somehow to me felt appropriate. And it goes like this. It is the wine that leads me on, the wild wine, that says the wisest man to sing on the top of his lungs, laugh like a fool, it drives the man to dancing. It even tempts him to blurt out stories better never told. In other words, I'm very much looking forward to the rest of the day. And I'm very thankful to have been part of your journey. Enjoy and celebrate today. And I wish you naturally all the best for the future. Thank you.
I thank you.
Dear Dr. Kalafati, also on behalf of the Board of Deans, I congratulate you with the honor you have acquired. In my opinion, the doctor's title is just one step to in your journey to Ithaca. And we wish you a further journey full of discovery, full of adventure, and also full of wisdom to real Ithaca. All the best. And before closing this ceremony, I will ask the audience to leave the auditorium. And in the meantime, we will take a picture in the main hall and here in the auditorium and also on the stairs in the main hall. And after that, we can congratulate the new doctor. I close the ceremony.